students. She has presented many national and international papers, and in the past she has received many awards, mainly in the state conferences, and she's also doing community work with the Rotary and other NGOs. With this, I request again our founder, Dr. Avalina Sahu, to present bouquet as well as the medal. So big applause for her. She is now the new chairperson of Women's Wing. Our vice chairperson is Dr. Manjiri Malekar Oak. She has her own hospital, Ameya Eye Clinic, and she is also attached to Fortis Hospital, Mumbai. She is an anterior segment surgeon interested in cataract, glaucoma, and refractive surgery. She has received many awards in MOSCON, the Innovation in Ophthalmic Practice Award for her new corneal marker for refractive surgery. She has also received Bell Pharma Award for non-penetrating filtering surgery for glaucoma, deep sclerectomy. She is recipient of prestigious V.K. Chitnis Oration Award for the exemplary work in the field of glaucoma, that is NPGS, NPGS with cross implant, and combined cataract and glaucoma surgery, as well as SICS and glaucoma surgery. She has designed her LASIK marker, which was presented in AIOC in the innovation section and was commercially also launched in 2015. She had presented in many state national conferences, invited as a guest faculty at all the levels. I request our incoming president of AIOS, Dr. Barun Naik, to present a medal as well as bouquet to Dr. Manjiri Malekar Oak.
Congratulations, Dr. Manjiri. All the best. And all the best.
Thank you, sir. It's my privilege and pleasure to be with this such a prestigious institution. Thank you, sir.
Yeah. Suri Dixit to say a few words.
Good evening, everyone. Dr. Varamani, it's really an honor for me to be the first chairperson of the ISM-SICS. And in fact, to tell you frankly, I'm a CEO of ISM-SICS. That is a chief encouragement officer. And that would be forever. So wherever there is SICS and MSICS all over the globe, I'm always there. So today is International Women's Day. So I wish each and every woman here a very happy Women's Day. And, let us challenge not only the external circumstances choose to challenge, but let us challenge ourselves to become better and better professionally and in a life at large without losing our smile. So thank you everyone very much. And I'm really glad our Women's Wing is taking such a nice structure and shape. And thank you, Sahu sir, for all the encouragement and all the best to all the executive members. I'm always with you. So we'll take it ahead. I'm hopeful for that. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I also request our new incoming chairperson to say a few words. Dr. Nita Shanbhag, please.
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Baramani. I would like to specially thank Dr. Amulya Sahu sir for the trust he has placed in me. I still remember a few years back when he had a great vision for ISM-SICS, and I used to wonder how far he is going to take it. And today he has proved all of us that yes, if you have a vision, you can definitely go ahead with it. I wish everybody over here a very happy Women's Day. And yes, thank you for installing me as the chairman. I would certainly strive very hard to fulfill the trust which has been placed in me, and we would definitely think of new innovative ways to go ahead. Madhuri has lighted the torch. I would like to carry it forwards. And once again, thank all of you all. It's going to be a teamwork. I may be the chairman, but I will require everybody's help to go ahead in this particular endeavor. And I request all of you all to cooperate with me along the course. Thank you so much.
Thank you. That was wonderful, Dr. Nita. So our new president will be Dr. Usha Johari, a very dynamic and senior lady from Mumbai. She is the past president of Bombay Ophthalmologist Association. She is also a member of executive committee of Indian Academy of Cerebral Palsy. She is Vice President of MDMPA. This is a Mahim Practitioners Association. She's a faculty regularly seen various national and state conferences. She is also interested in community activities, eye problems in cerebral palsy. And she is now the Chief Program Director of ISM-SICS-GSICS-TP. ISM-SICS-GSICS-TP is the new global SICS training program which we are going to launch soon. Regularly, every week, she is holding a meeting with different teachers for this program. And this will be a web-based program and a global teaching program. And she is showing a lot of interest and doing a lot of hard work along with Dr. Aishwarya and Dr. Manik Nicholson. So with this short introduction, I request again Dr. Amulya Sahu to present a medal as well as present a bhakti to Dr. Usha Johari. Dr. Usha Johari, a few words from you.
At the outset, I am extremely grateful to Dr. Amulya Sahu and Dr. Boramani for having laid trust on me and have given me a free hand to take this to a higher level. And I'm sure I will fulfill all the dreams of Dr. Amulya Sahu and Dr. Boramani. And I would take this, you know, with the help of all the women and all the global and the national faculty, I would take this way ahead. Only thing is, I would need some directions, because this is the first time that I've been given this post. And I promise you that I will strive hard to fulfill all the requirements and take it to a global level, because it's called as a global ISM-SICS program. And I'm sure we will all together, jointly with all the dynamic ladies on this platform, we will all do well. And thank you once again to Dr. Amulya Sahu especially, and of course Dr. Jagdish Jagannath Boramani, who has all, since 6 months, he's been helping me in all walks of life, body. Thank you very much.
Yeah. Thank you, Usha Madam. So our new vice president will be Dr. Parul Shah. Dr. Parul Shah is from Mumbai again. She is an expert FACO and SICS surgeon. She did her MS and DOMS from Mumbai, and her main interest is in the field of cataract, glaucoma, and cornea. She is the course director in FACO emulsification and SICS training at Lotus Eye Hospital, Juhu, Mumbai. She has presented multiple papers in national and international conferences, and she has conducted many skill transfer courses with live surgery, especially for Blumenthal's mini-nuke technique of SICS, as various conferences and various podiums at national as well as international levels. She had come with us in many international events of ISM-SICS and presented papers, videos, and performed live surgery also. So with this short introduction, I request Dr. Barun Nayak sir to present medal as well as bouquet to Dr. Parul Shah.
Once again, Parul, a great teacher, and congratulations and all the best in the new role. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah.
I'm really grateful to Dr. Boramani, and of course, Dr. Barun Nayak and Dr. Usha Johari. I'm very sorry to Sahu that he kept on pestering me. He used to keep giving me calls, you know, for participating actively. And somehow I just couldn't. So I'm really sorry, Dr. Amulya Sahu. But now, of course, definitely I'll put in my 100% and take this body forward and help whatever I can do. Thank you, everybody. And wishing all the female a very happy International Women's Day. Wishing you all a joy, good health, happiness, and success in future years. And we'll definitely take this Women's League to great heights with everybody's support. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Parul. So our next secretary will be again another dynamic lady from Haryana, Professor Manisha Rathi. She is from CMCH Vellore with the Victor. She has won the Victor Rombo Prize in Ophthalmology. She is Professor and HOD in the Glaucoma Department of Regional Institute of Ophthalmology, PGIMS Rohtak. She is a reviewer for American Journal of Ophthalmology, IJO, and other esteemed journals. She has over 30 publications in international indexed journals. And she has recently published an article on astigmatism in MSICS. She has a large series of trabeculectomy in patients of advanced cataract and glaucoma with an IOP of more than 50 mm of HG. She is a very enthusiastic teacher. We have started our simulation-based training program in Mumbai. She sent her students also, but she's so dynamic that with her students, she also came here and sat on the machine to get the experience of that simulator machine. With this introduction, I request Dr. Amulya Sahu to present a medal and memento to and bouquet to Dr. Manisha Rathi. So that was a medal. That was a bouquet with lot of claps. Dr. Manisha, can you say a few words?
Thank you so much, sir. This is really exciting. It's a special day. Thank you, Dr. Sahu, sir, Dr. Boramani, sir, Dr. Jory, ma'am, Dr. Madhuri Dixit, all the wonderful people here, all energetic, enthusiastic, and very committed. I shall try to follow in your footsteps and with your guidance. I really hope to work very hard, sir, in this, and we shall all take it to the new level. I will be the foot soldier who will follow all the other luminaries. Thank you so much, sir. It means a huge deal. I'm grateful and humbled. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Manisha. We have our co-secretary, Dr. Jayasree Barua from Assam. She is a consultant, head of comprehensive and community services, Tejpur Eye Hospital. She has specialization in entry segment and medical retina. She has actively participated in various national and international conferences. She has been regularly invited as guest faculty in many conferences. She is actively involved in clinics, academics, training, and research. Her areas of interest are surgical training programs. Presently, she is the state coordinator of Assam chapter of ISM-SICS. She is also joint secretary of ISM-SICS, Central ISM-SICS. With this introduction, we installed Dr. Jayasree Barua at the hands of Dr. Barun Nayak. The medal and the bouquet, please.
Welcome, Dr. Jayasree Barua, and definitely, Miss, with the introduction of this young blood, I'm sure this ISM-SICS is going to flourish, with great speed. All the best. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir, and thanks to the Central Committee of ISM-SICS for having the faith and the trust in me, and happy International Women's Day to all the young and to all the dynamic ladies out there. And together, we shall definitely try to carry this women's wing of ISM-SICS to higher levels, to greater heights. Thank you so much.
Yeah. Thank you, Dr. Jayasree. So we have new joint secretary, a very young Dr. Manik Nicholson. Dr. Manik Nicholson has completed her DNB from LVPI and also done FRCS from Glasgow. She has done fellowship in Narayan Netralaya, KB Haji Bacholi Eye Hospital, Mumbai, and Massachusetts Eye and Ear Infirmary, Boston. She was a consultant in LVPI, Vishakhapatnam. Presently, she is consultant at her own Nicholson Eye Clinic and Hospital. She has done SICS training at the International Mongolia Medicine Hospital through Fred Hollows Foundation. She has presented papers, posters, videos, and talks in various state, national, and international conferences. She has presented papers in published papers in many peer-reviewed journals, and she has also articles in various books. And she is the assistant program director in our ISM-SICS Global SICS Training Program. So, with this introduction, I request the past president of BOA, Dr. Usha Zohari, to present the medal as well as the bouquet to Dr. Manik Nicholson. Yeah. So there comes the medal and the bouquet. A few words from Dr. Manik.
Thank you so much, Dr. Sahu, Dr. Boramani, and Dr. Johari for this opportunity and for your faith in me. I hope to make you and all the dynamic women in this group proud and to live up to your expectations. And a very happy Women's Day to everyone in this group. Thank you.
Yeah. Thanks for those words, Dr. Manik. Let us move on to our new joint secretary, Dr. Kimaya Chauhan. Dr. Kimaya is DOMS from Rajiv Gandhi University, Bangalore. She has completed her DNB from Lyons NAB Hospital, Miraz in 2001. She was an observer in Minto Hospital, Bangalore. She has done fellowship in National Institute of Ophthalmology, Pune. She was SICS trainer in Lions NAP Eye Hospital for 1 year. She has conducted many SICS camps. She has presented many papers in Maharashtra State Ophthalmology Conference. She is a private practitioner in Mumbai, and she is also a consultant in Parvathibai Chavan Charitable Trust Hospital since last 20 years. So I request Dr. Amulya Sahu to install her as Joint Secretary and present the medal and the bouquet to her. Thank you. Dr. Kimaya, can you say a few words?
Yeah, thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much to have faith in me. I'm really honored to be a part of such prestigious venture, and I'll try my best and give justice to my post, sir. Thank you so much. Thank you so much.
Yeah, thank you very much, Dr. Kimaya. So we have new Joint Secretary, Dr. Nita Dodwad. Dr. Nita Dodwad is from Mumbai. She is also a gold medalist from Rajiv Gandhi University, Bangalore. She has done a short-term cornea fellowship at LVPI Institute, Hyderabad. She has done medical retina fellowships from Arvind Eye Hospital. She has served charitable institutes like Lions, NAB, Mirrors, and Sangli. She has presented papers at state conferences, and she owns a private hospital at Kandivali, Mumbai. She is also an honorary consultant at Prasad Chikitsa, Ganeshpuri. So with this introduction, I request Barun Naik sir to present the medal as well as the bouquet to Dr. Nita Dodwad.
Welcome, so and all the best and congratulations.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, sir. Few words from Dr. Nita.
Thank you so much, sir. I really feel very proud and privileged to work in such an esteemed venture that is ISM SICS, and such an excellent and talented, dynamic woman. Really feel proud, and I will keep myself working hard and keeping this project to a high level. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thanks for that, Dr. Nita. And this is almost the end of our installation ceremony. Our Vice Chairman, Dr. Parikshit Gokhte, is there in the meeting now. So I request Dr. Parikshit Gokhte to say a few thanksgiving words. Dr. Parikshit, please.
Good evening, sir. Thank you for including me in this. It's a very special day that on this 8th of April, which is the International Women's Day, we are having a changeover of the team of the women's wing of the ISMS-ICS. Ophthalmology has always been lucky to have... outstanding talent. And this time, Dr. Usha Johri, who is the new chairman, has also taken upon herself to start a more active academic section. So on behalf of ISMS-ICS, I would again like to thank Dr. Nita Shanbak, Dr. Manjari Malekar Oak, Dr. Johri Ma'am, Dr. Manjari.
Unmute yourself.
Dr. Kimaya Chavhan, Dr. Nita Dodwad, Dr. Manik Nicholson, and of course our advisor, Dr. Madhuri Dixit. And thanks again, of course, to Dr. Sahu for his brainchild of harnessing this great human resource that is there in ophthalmology, the woman power, for the betterment of manual SICS. Thank you, sir.
Yeah, thank you very much, Dr. Parikshit. So with this, we complete our installation ceremony. We wish all the best to the new team of Women's Wing of ISM-SICS. And we wish Happy Women's Day to all of you and all the women in the audiences. With this, we move on to our now Glaucoma CME on occasion of the World Glaucoma Week, and we hand over the stage to Dr. Karishma Wadia.
Thank you, sir. Thank you, everyone, for having me here. It's great to be with such a young, dynamic crowd and so many women today. So happy Women's Day to everybody. Without wasting much time, can I share my screen?
Yes.
Is it visible? 1 minute.
It's coming on.
Yes. Okay. Is it visible?
Yeah.
Yeah. So I would like to start by saying that we are doing this because we are in the World Glaucoma Week, and we'll start with our first speaker. It's an honor, sir, to introduce Dr. B.K. Nayak, sir, who is our current president-elect of the AIOS. He, as we all know, is the head of the department at Hinduja Hospital, Mumbai, and has also been a past editor of the JCOR and the second vice president of MOS. And we all know how he has conducted multiple CMEs and is always there to help us for anything during concern with the BOA. Without wasting much time, sir, over to you, Dr. B.K. Nayak.
Okay. Thank you very much for inviting me and giving me this opportunity. I don't have to share, means I have nothing to share in any slide share, but I'll just talk. Just now we saw the topic, which is there, the perimetry in glaucoma, the importance of perimetry. So I think I will just give some important points I'm going to talk. But before that, it's a hats off to Amulya Sahu for his dedication and commitment and persistence. Because any other person, because on many occasions I have been with him in this journey, but I must admit that I was not always there with him all the time, but definitely morally I was always there with him. But one thing I just heard some time back, Ms. Manik Shah had said that leaders are not born. Because he said if leaders would have been born, then in India, the population is so big, and every year, basically we are adding the population of more than Australian population. So then you can imagine that how many leaders, but still there are lack of leaders in India. So it means leaders are not born, they are made. So it means there must be some qualities for really the being a leader. And one of the I'm quoting his words only, Field Marshal Manik Shaw. He said that for leadership, you give me any person, and if he has professional competence and professional knowledge, I will make him a leader. So this is what Dr. Amulya Sahu is, and this is what he is doing for a great job for ISMS-ICS. And it's really, Mrs. I also sometimes envy that he has been pushing it, and now his dream is really turning into a reality. And also what I see that he is not only pushing himself, but also creating so many leaders. So he is picking up potential leaders and trying to inculcate or trying to force him to become leader, which is a great job that he is doing. And just one point which probably I will just say, that all the leaders who are going to be the future leaders and the new leaders, that is just think that something, whatever you're doing, which is for the good of the society, not only just because these days what happens, anyone who takes a post, say earlier one had conducted 15 CMEs, you will say, I will conduct 20. And then you get you think that you are great. You try to pat on your back itself. But that is not something. These days in the webinar era, it's very simple to conduct programs. It's because there is hardly any money involved, hardly any effort involved. Just simply ring up some person and tell them everyone is eagerly waiting to grab the opportunity, and they will come and you will do it. But you don't know really, is it producing any result? Because in the beginning, there was a lot of enthusiasm for webinar because it was something was new. That time it was lockdown, so everyone was locked in the house. Now the things have changed, but the situation I see has not changed. So that probably one has to think that whatever we are doing, it has to be with substance and really useful, then definitely do it. I have no objection in that, but not just for the sake of just counting 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, it should not be. So this is what that message I thought I must convey. And along with Amulya Sahu's journey, the Bora Mani is the real pillar, and Parikshit Gokhte, these two. So So probably I will say that this triad has been really means pushing ISMS, ICS, and means taking it over all over the world. So it's a great job done, and all three of you need a really a, means it's a big round of applause.
Thanks, thanks. We're overwhelmed.
thank you, VK.
And now I'll just
You have been always there.
No, I have always been there. But one thing is about me is that unless I give my full heart, I don't get myself satisfied that I am there. So that is because I, if you ask me really from my inside my heart, I will definitely say that I was not throughout in this journey when you started in the first form this society, ISMS, ICS, until today. Means it's definitely I have been joining, going back, again joining, and like that. So in between, for a short period, I was joining, but really, it's you are great, no doubt about it.
You have given a lot of support to us, lot of support.
He is the incoming president of ISMS ICS.
Yes.
We are going to have the world conference that time in LV Prasad.
No, so that's really, really, it's a great honor that you are bestowing on me. And thanks a lot, all the office bearers of ISMS ICS, for considering me for that position. Okay. Now, coming to the today's topic, perimetry, because in 10 minutes, I thought I cannot talk about anything about perimetry in detail, that interpretation or what. But there's a certain point which I want to highlight, that in a glaucoma, without perimetry, you cannot manage glaucoma. Without OCT, yes, there is no problem, you can do. But without perimetry, if someone goes to court of law, you will have no defense. So it is that important. Now, perimetry, and because of computerized perimetry, the importance have become very high because it is reproducible. And you should realize the importance of perimetry in glaucoma management is twofold. One is for the initial diagnosis, establishing a diagnosis, because if you are suspecting that it is based on certain findings on the disc, on the nerve fiber layer, and the pressure, then you, and the perimetric field effect, if it correlates with your suspicion, then with your clinical condition, then you establish a diagnosis. And perimetry is so important because that establishes established glaucoma or pre-perimetric glaucoma. Because if other suspicion is there, but if this is not there in perimetric defect, then you level it. And still, if there is some confusion, miss, whether we should really level it pre-perimetric glaucoma or not, it's a big debate. But at least the perimetry is so important that it segregates the different type of glaucoma patients. Now, that is number one use. The number two use is during follow-up, because whenever you are treating a glaucoma patient, you know that glaucoma patient, whether you're treating with medical treatment, laser treatment, or surgery, the patient is going to be lifelong with you on follow-up. He cannot escape, just like diabetes or hypertension. So perimetry helps you to determine whether whatever I am doing is sufficient or not, because the same intraocular pressure may not be ideal for each and every patient. For some, 19 may be perfectly okay, but for others, for some, maybe 17 may not be sufficient. You have to bring it down further. But how will you decide? Progression. So the perimetry will tell you that this patient is, whatever you are doing with that treatment, it is still progressing. So that, and that this also segregates between two types of people, one who are rapid progressor and the one who are slow progressor. Because rapid progressor, you have to be more aggressive in treatment. If it is slow progressor, and if his age is on his side, it's based on that. Because if it is slow progressor, early glaucomatous field defect, and age is advanced, means 60 or 60 plus, then you know this patient's life expectancy is not much. It's the maximum 20 years. 20 years you have to maintain his vision. So you may not be that aggressive. But same thing at the age of 20, 30 or 35 or 40, but this patient has to live for very long. So you will be more aggressive in treatment. So this, again, how will you decide? Perimetry only, because you have started, suppose a patient of glaucoma has come to you and you have established the diagnosis properly. You have started treatment. Whatever you have started, suppose you have thought of some target pressure in the eye and you have achieved. But this target pressure, that was target pressure you decided in the beginning of the start of the treatment. That the problem with target pressure is that time you will never know that your pressure was, your judgment was right or wrong, unless you have followed it up for 2 years or 3 years and you see still it is. So it is progressing with this target pressure also. It means your treatment is not sufficient. You have to bring it down further. So Miss, I am giving you example to highlight the importance of perimetry. So perimetry, so these two facts, if you remember, then probably you will be using perimetry properly in glaucoma patients. Now, one thing what I have noticed, that any field effect in where you are suspecting glaucoma and you have done perimetry, any type of field effect, suddenly you jump to conclusion that this is glaucomatous field effect. No, all types of perimetric field effect is not glaucomatous. So you have to really understand what are the specific type of glaucomatous perimetric defect. And especially the more, not confusing, but the sometimes which is gets intermingled, that if the patient is having any field effect which is having a hemianopic pattern, means the vertical separation, then probably you can be rest assured this field effect is not glaucomatous, but it is neurological and from the optic pathway, somewhere from chiasma to the occipital cortex. So this fact also you should remember, because then many times patients are unnecessarily being treated considering the patient is glaucoma based on some kind of field effect which was not glaucomatous but neurological field effect. Now the next point which I wanted to highlight, that now you have realized that perimetry initial test is important, follow-up is also important, so that you can judge the progression. For that purpose, means with that aim in mind, you have to do perimetry always on the same machine, and not only the same make of machine, because the data is not transferable. So how will you judge that whatever was the previous field effect, the subsequent field effect, and today's field effect, what has happened, unless you have done it on the one machine itself, and there you have the software to have this follow-up evaluation. So for that purpose, you should not advise that, okay, get it done today here, tomorrow somewhere else, the third day from some other clinic, but that also on different machine, because these data are not interchangeable, not transferable. So this fact also you should remember, keep in mind. And the last thing also I want to emphasize, that perimetry always, there is a learning curve. So suppose, means why I am giving some example, the first time a patient comes to you and you are suspecting glaucoma, you have, or maybe doubtful glaucoma, but you have suggested perimetry and it was done, and there is a field effect. Now this field effect, first thing you should correlate, whether it's whatever my clinical suspicion is, that field effect should be in this area, whether it is there in that area or not. If it is yes, correlating, it's fine. If not, or otherwise also, the first time whatever field effect you have got it, you should not rely on this, because you have to, unless you repeat the test and you can reproduce the same defect second time, then only you take this field as the real field. So sometimes 3-4 fields you have to do in the beginning to get the real field of that particular field of vision of that particular patient. So this fact also, because there is a learning curve, so this fact also you have to keep in mind, because if you will not do that, then you will, just some field effect has come, you start treatment, diagnosing glaucoma, next time patient comes, the field effect disappears, you are very happy, you will start patting your back, that now I have treated and the field effect has disappeared, which is actually not. It is probably it was something wrong interpretation. So therefore, in the beginning of the case itself, when the case has come to you, you should establish a good baseline parameter for perimetry as well as intraocular pressure. So only one examination is not sufficient. So with this, I think I have probably emphasized the important points related to perimetry. And just one word of caution, that always I say OCT in relation to glaucoma is probably the most abused machine in ophthalmology, because sometimes you just do it and you get some red areas and you simply diagnose glaucoma and start treatment, which is not correct. And according to me, the role of OCT is only in the beginning of pre-perimetric stage. Once the perimetric field defect has appeared, then the role becomes very, very limited for OCT. So I think now I have made the points clear. And thank you very much once again for giving me this opportunity.
Thank you so much, sir, for these lovely tips. I think without wasting any time, we can move on to our next speaker. Our next speaker is Dr. Shefali Parekh. She is trained at the L.V. Prasad Institute at Hyderabad and is currently the medical director of Shriji Eye Clinic and Palak's Glaucoma Center at Andheri, and is also the West Zone representative of the Glaucoma Society of India. Over to you, Dr. Shefali.
Thank you, Dr. Kalpana. I'll just share my screen.
Yes.
So good evening, everybody. And I would like to thank Dr. Usha Johri for giving me this opportunity. Is it visible? Visible?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes.
So today, along with World Glaucoma Week, we are also celebrating the International Women's Day. So I congratulate all the women who have been installed, as well as I commend all the women who, just by being there, they are making this society a better place to live. So with this, I'll start my talk, which is on the minimally invasive glaucoma surgery. So just starting with the basics, we know that at this point of time, glaucoma surgeries are conjunctival dependent. Therefore, all the limitations of conjunctiva, that is fibrosis or the bleb leak and the infection, they are part of those surgery. So there comes the role of minimally invasive glaucoma surgery, or MIGS, which are defined as the implantation of a surgical device to reduce the intraocular pressure via an ab interna or ab external approach. And the advantage of this surgery is that either there is no or very minimal scleral and conjunctival dissection and manipulation. Therefore, the safety profile is excellent. So depending on the site where it works, at the site of its working, we can classify the MIGS into four types. First one, which act at the trabecular meshwork by reducing the resistance at the trabecular meshwork. Second group falls into, which increases the vascular outflow pathway via suprachoroidal pathway. Third group, which reduces the aqueous production from the ciliary body. And the fourth one, which creates the subconjunctival drainage pathway. So there is a long list of MIGS, so which I am not going to discuss, but I'll be discussing very few which are either in the market in the other countries. Of course, in India, we don't have any of such device at this point of time. But there are few which you may see in near future in our country also. So first class is which works on the juxtacanalicular trabecular meshwork. They are iStent and the Hydrus. So iStent, I will be a little short only. This is how the design looks. The stent is basically 1 into 0.3 millimeter in height. And we know that it works on the trabecular pathway. It reduces the resistance at the trabecular meshwork. Now, if you put in the anterior chamber, this is how the lumen will look. And I'm going to show a few videos. And this, all the videos which I'm showing, that have been borrowed. So this is the video of the iStent. Now, this most of the techniques which I'm going to describe, they follow ab interna approach. And here, first, and the indication is open angle glaucoma. And first, we form the anterior chamber with the viscoelastic. And then we, with the help of the gonioscope, we locate the posterior trabecular mesh fold, because here the site of action is the Schlemm's canal, and we know the Schlemm's canal is located behind the PTM. So I'll just make it a little bit faster. So this is how the iStent looks. You can see it is comes preloaded. This is how iStent looks. So once we have already formed the, with the help of a side port, we have formed the anterior chamber also, then you simply inject the iStent, and while injecting it, we keep on visualizing the angle structure so that so as to locate the posterior trabecular meshwork. And all these procedures, as they are near the iris and the ciliary body, so one of the main limitation or one of the main side effect or sequelae is hyphema, intraoperative bleeding, that we have to take care. Now, in fact, it is the promoters of eye stent, they are saying that, in fact, two stent in the same eye, it works better compared to the one stent. This is, you just, once you have reached the posterior trabecular meshwork, you have to simply inject the stent. Now, another stent which works again at the Schlemm's canal or the trabecular meshwork is the Hydrus. Though it is not approved by US FDA, but in Europe, it is being practiced. And this stent, it is 8 millimeter long crescent-shaped stent, and it works again on the trabecular meshwork by reducing the resistance at the trabecular meshwork. This is a short video. Same, it is ab interno. Once informed the anterior chamber with the help of a viscoelastic, locate the posterior trabecular meshwork and you inject the stent after locating the posterior trabecular meshwork. The limitation is same. Hyphema is common after this procedure. So next come the another class of drug is the these devices which works at the supracoroidal space. Now the supracoroidal space at this point of time, it is the most unexplored space. And however, it has the maximum potential. If you see the prostaglandin analog, the drugs which have the maximum efficacy, they also works on the visceral outflow pathway. But the this space, any stent in the supracoroidal space, unfortunately, they all have been withdrawn from the market. One of them is the Cypass recently, which was introduced, but because of the endothelial damage, it was withdrawn. Another was the gold shunt. Both of them, they worked on the supracoroidal space. However, both of them have been withdrawn from the market. So I'm not going to discuss them. Next is the subconjunctival space, stents which we can put in the subconjunctival space. This is the most traditional outflow pathway for glaucoma drainage surgery. And the one of the most common is the Zen implant. You can see a few photographs. This Zen, once you implant in, this is the how the lumen looks. And this is the subconjunctival implant. You can see the length of the implant, that how it is put into the subconjunctival space. This is how the implant looks. And again, it comes preloaded. So Zen, again, it is a 6 millimeter cylinder made up of collagen, and it works on the Pauli law of laminar flow. And this creates a channel through the sclera, allowing a flow of aqueous humor from the anterior chamber into the subconjunctival space. It's again a short video. Now, again, it is ab externo. Now, before implanting the Zen, we have to measure. Now, we know it is 6 millimeter in length. We have to measure and we have to mark on the conjunctiva so that where to mark its interior as well as the distal end of the this stent. Ab interno method, again, you inject viscoelastic into the anterior chamber, and exactly diagonally opposite to it, you make the entry with the side port, inject viscoelastic, and then again, this is preloaded Zen implant. If you can see here, this is also preloaded, and then you simply inject it through the anterior chamber, and so that it comes out into the subconjunctival space, and once it reaches that marked site of the distal end, it will simply release the stent. Last is microshunt, which is being marketed by Centen at this point of time, and near future we may have this. And its lumen is very narrow, which allows fluid to pass. However, it is small and long enough to prevent the hypertony. This is how this microshunt or InFocus, it is being marketed in the name of InFocus. This is how it looks. And it is made up of the SIPS material, which is of the same material, which is also used for there's a cardiac stent. And this is the video from IKEA Ahmed. This is the only stent which we put as an ab externo. We have to make the same conjunctival dissection
We have to make processes are going to use to cut that.
We have to make the conjunctival dissection just as we do in the glaucoma filtration surgery.
Directions here,
and
left,
we can use antifibrotics also.
The device is in total length 8 and therefore going 3 millimeters back for the limit.
Then we have to make the about 5 to 6 millimeters.
One can basically mark from the spinal spur 2 millimeters back and dissect anteriorly to be sure of adequate length.
With the help of a 23-gauge needle, we have to simply insert and we have to make around 5 to 6 millimeter long tunnel and we have to inject the infocus. It is just like if you are doing AGV, the tubes, then it is just like injecting in the, they are like tube into the this scleral tunnel that we have made. And then we have to simply close the conjunctiva just we do in the other glaucoma filtration surgery. So in the end, though like other device, there are limitations of minimally invasive glaucoma surgery also. Of course, this efficacy of minimally invasive glaucoma surgery is not like trabeculectomy. We can achieve only up to 20 to 25% of the intraocular pressure reduction. Unlike trabeculectomy, it has also potential for hyphema, IOP spikes, stent obstruction, and inflammation. And at the same time, at this point of time, we don't know its long-term results about what is the maximum potential of this procedure. However, and also they are very costly at this point of time. So in our country, it is definitely it is difficult to give this benefit of this procedure to our patients. However, it has a number of advantages, like because it causes around 20 to 25% intraocular pressure reduction, it can be used along with the cataract surgery. It can improve adherence. And the visual rehabilitation with the mix is also very fast compared to what we see in the current glaucoma surgery. So definitely mix has a lot of potential in future. We have still, this needs to be explored. And maybe one of the first thing is that once the cost is reduced, then definitely in our country, it has a lot of potential. With this, thank you once again.
Thank you, Dr. Shefali. That was really very informative. We'll now move on to our next speaker. Our next speaker is Dr. Parul Shah. We all know her as the dynamic surgeon who is the course director of the FACO training at Lotus Eye Hospital. And she has multiple years of experience as an anterior segment surgeon and is currently the new vice president of this very society. Over to you, Dr. Parul.
Can you share my screen?
Yes, you may share your screen.
Can you see?
Yes, ma'am, we can see it. Thank you.
I'm going to, without wasting much time, because we don't have much time, I'll go ahead with my topic. Mainly, I'll show that how we can use hologen implant very safely and prevent all the complications of trabeculectomy, like scar formation, have a good bleb without using mitomycin. Mitomycin is a very good fibrolytic agent, but it is accompanied by increase in many adverse effects such as cataract formation, avascular filtering bleb, thinning of the conjunctiva, sloughing of conjunctiva, which can lead to blebitis and endophthalmitis. While this is a very safe procedure, so basically, what is hologen? Hologen is nothing but it is an collagen matrix where 90% is porcine collagen and 10% is lyophilized glycosamine glycan. Now, I'll not go in the initial steps. You take a fornix-based conjunctival flap. Only thing is you have to dissect the conjunctiva quite behind and on the side so that you can put the hologen implant. It is just behind the below the conjunctiva, so between the episclera and the conjunctiva at the end of the trabeculectomy. So it prevents any adhesions or scarring formation. And basically the size of the pores of this matrix is 10 to 300 microns, and it is biodegradable. And second thing is it is non-reactive. It does not cause any reaction, non-toxic, and very safe, even if you are doing a combined surgery. And it prevents any scarring. Basically, it provides a space between the conjunctiva and the episclera, as well as it, the matrix forms a scaffold for an aqueous to flow in this pores. And the aqueous channels forms, and this gets absorbed at the end of 6 to 12 months. So you have a long time for an aqueous channel to form, and it gives an excellent bleb right from beginning. So I take normally a trapezoid outer flap instead of taking a triangular flap. Only thing to remember here is that when you are suturing the outer scleral flap, the sutures are very loose. It is just to approximate the ends. You should not do it very tightly. So I generally take three sutures, one at the base of the trapezoid, meaning at the apex of the trapezoid, and two on the sides with 10-0 nylon. So these are the three interrupted sutures. And only important thing is how you suture your conjunctiva. That is very, very important, because you have to modulate your conjunctival suturing when you're putting an ologen implant. So I'll be showing you how to do it. So once you have sutured the outer flap, this is the collagen implant, ologen implant, which is of collagen. You push it a little behind. Don't put it in front. Then pull the conjunctiva and anchor the conjunctival suture to the limbus. So my first suture goes through the limbus, and then through the conjunctiva, I take a purse string sutures. So you go from inside out on the conjunctiva. So just pull the conjunctiva so you know that how much type to make the suturing. And at the end, you pull both the ends and tie it. And you can see that the conjunctiva anchors to your limbus very well. And it does not recede, or it doesn't get retracted, because if the conjunctiva gets retracted, if you're not sutured it properly, then your ologen implant can get extruded. So this is very important to modulate. You can see my first suture is going through the limbus and then through the conjunctiva. Even conjunctiva, you don't have to pull much over the conjunctiva, over the cornea. It has to be just 1 millimeter inside the limbus. And here again, I've taken a purse string suture. And this purse string suture has to be very tight, so there is no leakage of the aqueous, and the bleb forms very fast. You will see that at end of the surgery from the side port, when I'm injecting saline, you can see that the instant the bleb is formed and there is no leakage. The bleb is remaining even if I'm pressing it over the cornea. So you can see that ologen gives an excellent results. Even immediately the bleb forms, and long term also. I have started using ologen implant from last almost 7-8 years. And nowadays I do all my trabeculectomy with ologen implant with excellent results and a very good pressure lowering effect without any side effects of mitomycin. And I can safely use in combined surgeries also. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Dr. Parul. That was really informative. We'll now move on to our last speaker for tonight. Dr. Parul, ma'am, you'll have to end your share screen so that I can share mine.
Sure. Yeah.
Yeah. Our last speaker for today is none other than Dr. Usha Johari, ma'am. It is my privilege to get to introduce her today. She has been our past president of BOA and is the president of the women's wing of the MSSICS. She, I must say, has been involved in multiple academic activities. She's very academically oriented, and I must thank her for founding the Young Ophthalmologists BOA group and really giving a push to the younger generation. Thank you so much, ma'am. Over to you. Usha ma'am, you can unmute yourself.
Can I share my screen? Yeah. Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Very good evening to all of you. After the dynamic talks of Dr. Shefali and Dr. Parul, this is my last talk, which is the end of the day, that is the women empowerment. So you'll all agree with me, it's a woman who runs and she leads. And of course, the society's responsibility is to create a very supportive environment for all the aspiring women. So what, you know, we all know that Mahatma Gandhi once mentioned that if you educate a man, you educate an individual, but if you educate a woman, you educate the entire family. This was told by Mahatma Gandhi, you know, long time back. Now let's see what Mother Teresa has done. She devoted her life for destitutes and poor. Not all of us can do great things, but we can definitely do small things with great love. And to educate a girl is to reduce poverty, which has been said by the former UN secretary. Now, power to give a birth to a new life, of course, it's only the women, and the women has been placed on a very high pedestal because women possess the creative power, and why not we transfer this to the mankind? Now, the whole world, you know, surprisingly, is in the hands of women. So the talent and determination to reach a higher summit is of success is in the hands of women. See the Shakti power of a woman. And now comes the ambitions which are shattered by the male domination. So the appearance of women, a weak woman, a fragile woman, a vulnerable woman, and balancing between the home and work. So what did Dr. Ambedkar do during the women liberation? We shall see, he said, we shall see better days soon, and our progress will be greatly accelerated if male education is pursued side by side with the female education. His thoughts were highly opposed by the orthodox people, but how can we ignore this, him now? How many women or the girls know about the Hindu code bill? So back to B2B approach, back to the basics, and back to the core values. These are my parents. I am there because of you. And my role is to anchor in keeping family together and maintaining a friction-free relationship. Now behind it, there is a saying that behind every successful man, there is a woman. I would put it the other way around. Behind every woman is a successful man. That's my husband, holding hands, thinking of my progress, support, encourage, and standby. What more do I want? Now, what society expects from a woman? Women has to be very graceful. She should be charming, soft-spoken, gentle. But look at the other side of it. A woman is expected to be tough, independent, and a solution provider. Now, these are a few moments of my life. And if I have believed in it and I could do it, we all can do it. Now, women's assets, I'm sure, are friendship, love, and affection. Why can't we encash this? And let's encash this and see some of the women who have inspired the whole world. Dr. Boni Ann Henderson, she was a cataract and a refractive surgery from Tufts University of School. Dr. Cynthia Mattox, she's been elected president of the American Glaucoma Society. Dr. Cynthia Bradford, Dean of McGee Institute, Oklahoma. Dr. Beatrice, the president of European Society of Cataract and Refractive Surgery. Cynthia Roberts, professor and Department of Ophthalmology and Visual Science, professor of Biomedical Engineering, USA. Dr. Emily Chu, director, the Division of Epidemiology and Clinical Applications from USA. And see how many women have inspired India. Dr. Anandibai Gopal Rao Joshi, an Indian female physician. Dr. Manjula Anagani, obstetrician, gynecologist. Dr. Rukma Bai Raut, Indian physician and feminist. Dr. Indira Hinduja, gynecologist, obstetrician, and infertility specialist. Dr. Padmavati, a very renowned cardiologist. Dr. Jayashree Monkar, a neonatologist. and many more such women, Dr. Ketayam Dinsha, Dr. Shashi Wadhwa, who is anatomy and the developmental neuroscience professor, Dr. M. Subhadra Nair, a renowned gynecologist, Dr. Ajita Chakraborty, Dr. Kasturi Raja Diksha, Dr. Neelam Clare, a neonatologist. So our specialty is progressing. Let's see the women in action. Feminism is not making women strong. We are already strong. It's about changing the way the world perceives us. Our specialty is progressing, and you'll all agree with me that our numbers are also increasing. This is some of the activity which we are carrying out under the Johri Medical and Research Foundation. And action of heroism done by women is often, it often goes unnoticed. So these are some of the community activities we did: school screening camp, cataract surgeries, all under the banner of JMRF, free of cost. And let's give back to the society for a good cause. There is enormous vitality waiting to be trapped, and let's march forward with this vitality and the power that we have. So I would conclude saying that at the end of the day, let's remind ourselves that what we did the best we could do today, that's enough. And a big thank you to all for your patience hearing. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Dr. Usha. That brings us nearly to the end of this meeting. We just have a short video that Mr. Raman will be doing on behalf of Entod Pharma. Mr. Raman, are you here?
Yes, ma'am. I'll just share the screen.
Yes.
So today we have a dual occasion. So on the occasion of the World Glaucoma Week, our Executive Director, Nikhil Masurkar, sir, has given the message on the free glaucoma therapy for the life. So this is the video.
We all know how difficult it can be to diagnose, treat, and manage a condition like glaucoma. As a leading ophthalmic pharmaceutical company, we've been actively involved in cutting-edge research in glaucoma therapies and formulation technologies for over two decades now. As part of our commitment towards this cause, we are delighted to announce the launch of our Free Glaucoma Therapy for Life campaign on the occasion of the World Glaucoma Week 2021. As part of this campaign, Entod will commit to financially support 250 needy patients around the world with their glaucoma medicines for life. We thank the World Glaucoma Association, together with glaucoma societies around the world, for their support for this cause. This campaign aims not just to support those who are unable to afford their regular glaucoma medicines, but also raise the awareness of glaucoma, which is one of the leading causes of blindness in the world.
And second occasion that we have it today, the International Women Day. On that occasion, the Nari Shakti and initiative of the Entod Pharmaceutical for the woman empowerment in women in medical fraternity, women in ophthalmology, women, those who is working as our employee from the head office as well as in the field. So this both the initiative is brought to you by AB Press, our branch, and DO2. Thank you so much, ma'am. Over to you.
Thank you so much, Mr. Raman. That brings us to the end of this lovely meeting. I would request all of y'all who are present over here, if you can just turn on your video for one moment, we can take a group photograph and then call it a night. Once everyone's videos are on, I'll do a short 3-2-1 and then we'll click a photo. Is Dr. Nayak here too, sir?
Yes,
Mr. Raman, sir, you can also join us. The other